Bill, let's talk about Sacramento nightlife and the history in Sacramento of the entertainment scene. At the moment, it seems kind of like a ghost town to me. I don't know. What do you think? Was there ever a time when it was just a really happening scene?
It's always been really happening if you knew where to look. I think one of the legacies of Prohibition is that it's made people a little cautious about telling people where the cool stuff is because you're afraid the cops are going to show up and bust it. People talk about hipsters now, but the term hipster is not a new term. It comes from the hip man, which was the guy in the restaurant who had a flask of brandy in his hip pocket. And if you were hip, you knew who to ask to connect you with what was happening, which was some of that brandy in his bottle. And the idea is that if they get busted, you can say it's just that one guy. You can't close down the restaurants. And so what was hip in Sacramento in the 20s, obviously Prohibition's on, but there were plenty of speakeasies, but Sacramento was a center for Hollywood entertainment.
Really?
There was a craze in the 1920s for steamboat films, mostly films set in the American South or along the Mississippi River, set in the mid-19th century. It was a bit like zombie movies today. There was just this whole rash of them during the 1920s. And if you're a Hollywood producer and you want to make a steamboat picture, it's a lot cheaper and easier to go up to Sacramento where we have a river and we have riverboats than to go all the way to the Mississippi and try to do something in St. Louis or something.
Wow. Did that include the Delta King?
The Delta King was around then. It actually was featured, it wasn't around until 1926, so it missed out on the first part of that wave, and then it was too busy actually being a riverboat. But there was a Tom Sawyer film that was shot that used the Delta King in the background to provide effects. But a lot of Sacramento River riverboats were used as Mississippi riverboats. But part of an effect of that and another part of that decision, is Prohibition tended to be pretty strongly enforced in the American South, too. And that was another reason against actually doing your Mississippi River scenes on Mississippi. Whereas in Sacramento, it was very lax. And some movie producers came up here and were really surprised. They showed up, they were expecting this quiet little river town, where they found this vibrant city, which had all this nightlife happening. So you had dance clubs, places like the Trianon Ballroom, which was above the Fox Senator Theater. You had dime a dance or taxi dance clubs where you would essentially rent a girl for 10 cents a ticket to dance with you. But there were also places like the Dreamland Dance Hall, which had more public dances and things like that. You had theaters of all sorts. You had movie theaters, of course, but you also had vaudeville and dramatic theaters.
Was the Crest Theater part of that?
The Crest Theater wasn't around yet. The Crest Theater started out actually as the Empress. It was rebuilt as the Hippodrome in 1918. And it didn't become the Crest until 1949. So during Prohibition, during the 20s, it was still the Hippodrome. So it was primarily showing silent films. And then the Senator and the Alhambra were both built during this period. And there was really a game of one-upmanship. Who can build the more dramatic million-dollar theater? And those are the ones that got all the attention, the big, dramatic million-dollar places with named architects like George Sellin or Leonard Starks being the ones who drew up the plans for it. But there were dozens of these little theaters, places like the M&M on L Street and 7th, that were maybe open just for a couple of years, and sometimes they were specialty film places. They would just show newsreels. There was one theater. It was kind of like the CNN of theaters. You just have newsreels going on, and they change them every day. There were other small dramatic theaters. There was the Nippon Theater on L Street, which was a Japanese theater. They showed Japanese language films there because it was part of Japantown. And then over time, a lot of the small theaters went out of business, and some of them became cabarets. They became burlesque houses and strip clubs in the 50s.
How about Old Ironsides? That was around way back, what, in the 20s?
Well, no, it wasn't around in the 20s. It was opened up after Prohibition.
Okay.
Prior to its ownership by the Bordiso family, it was owned by a family that is spelled, I think his name is John Clark, and they probably had a saloon in there, but it was more of a dry goods general merchandise store, and supposedly, I think according to one account, it may have been a saloon or a tavern at one point. Old Ironsides has the the recognition of having Sacramento's first officially issued alcohol permit after the end of Prohibition, but there were plenty already open by that point. There were probably just, and I was reading about the end of Prohibition, and one kind of irony of it is that the end of Prohibition closed more speakeasies in Sacramento than Prohibition ever had. All of a sudden, oh, you don't need to be a speakeasy. You can just open up as a legal bar. And a lot of them couldn't pack it as legal bars because they had to sell quality product. You couldn't sell watered down junk.
So what was the nature of a speakeasy? Say you walk into a place, would you know it was a speakeasy just by walking into it? Or was there a secret underground section?
It depends. There were all sorts of variants. Sometimes it would just be a regular restaurant with a guy with a hip flask in his pocket who'd pour a drink into your cup of tea for an extra couple of dollars. In other cases, they would be extensive places with secret entrances. The Chambers Room, for example, the rumor, I don't know whether it's true, was that that was accessed from the basement of the Chamber of Commerce, which was right next door. And then they were all over the city. In Japantown, for example, there was a record of a bust, I think in 1926, of a couple hundred gallons of homemade sake that had originally been made in the Delta and then brought to downtown Sacramento. And I'm fairly certain that the same spot there on M Street that was busted a couple years later became the M Street Cafe, which was the epicenter for the Japanese jazz scene and bands like the Mikados.
Now there was a speakeasy on the Sacramento River, somewhere like kind of south of Sacramento?
There were many. There were speakeasies in Locke. There were speakeasies on Grand Island. Riverboats were not so much watercraft as gigantic loopholes, because the Sacramento River sits between two county lines. Neither the Sacramento nor Yolo sheriff really wanted to step out into the river and create a dispute over whose territory it was. So if you were on a riverboat, you were practically immune to state laws regarding prohibition.
So I'm thinking of one particular hotel. I cannot remember what it's called, but a lot of famous people stayed there.
The Riot Hotel?
That's what it is, yeah. So the
roadhouses in the Delta and places like that were pretty popular just because they were remote. You could carry on very loudly. You didn't have to be secretive about it. You didn't have to set up a special password or a knock. Obviously, you needed a car to get out there, so it was a little less accessible during the 1920s when not everybody had an automobile, or at least a ride. But for the more well-to-do, it was definitely a popular option. But it was hardly necessary. Where St. Rose of Lima Park is, there used to be a post office. And the post office is where the local prohibition office was based. And within one block of that post office, there were at least 20 speakeasies. So there was no shortage right here in town. You could walk.
Bill, let's wrap this up with a look at the decades real quickly. What do you think were the top decades in the past century for Sacramento's entertainment scene?
Well, like I said, Prohibition in the 20s definitely had a lot going for it, even if they had to keep it on the QT. The 30s, not so much, but there was the beginnings of Sacramento's jazz district. The 40s exploded, both with the club district and the West End, the African-American owned clubs like the Zanzibar, the Momo Club, the Congo Club. You also have places like Buddy Bear's and Top of the Town in the Elks building. We were on the radar. We were on every circuit. Every touring band came through here. Celebrities would show up here because they knew things were going on and a lot of things were happening. In the 1950s, there was plenty going on, but it started to reach an ebb when the city started to demolish downtown, when redevelopment started to go into effect, and then slowly drifting down into the 70s, but then you had the beginnings of a resurgence in the 70s. A lot of independent music was happening and stuff that just learned how to happen under the radar again. And it's a tradition that's kept through to the present day. There was also an explosion in the 90s, especially in the punk scene, the punk resurgence. There were amazing bands. There were a lot of people who moved to Sacramento specifically to be part of the music scene during that decade.
A lot of signings out of Sacramento.
Yes, a lot of well-known artists that started out here and moved on to bigger, better things. The difference, I think, in the recent decade, I think there's a lot of exciting stuff going on right now, is that artists and musicians who come from Sacramento now are less worried about the baggage that saying you're from Sacramento brings you. They expected to be a little more proud of it and a little more willing to say, yes, I'm a Sacramento. This is where I live. I'm still proud to live. Many of them still live here or aren't afraid to represent the city they're from because we have a real musical legacy and an artistic legacy that not enough people know about. If there's one message to get out there about local history is that we are a city of culture, not necessarily the highfalutin elite culture, but an urban culture, a city culture, and a rich culture of music, food, art, creativity, theater, in all forms.
Multicultural credibility.
Exactly.
Thanks for sharing Sacramento history.